Good evening, everyone, and welcome. I'm Brock Reeve, the Executive Director of the Harvard Stem Cell Institute, and we are very happy to host you tonight at the third of our series in Horizons of Regenerative Medicine on the topic of aging. And as part of the Hub Week collaboration that has happened all week between Harvard, MIT, The Globe, and Mass General. Hub Week, as you may know, is a first of its kind, but this is the second iteration of it, civic engagement to explore the intersection of art, science, and technology, and all the fascinating things that can happen as a result. So in the course of the week, over 130 organizations have come together to celebrate the future in Boston by hosting open studios, film festivals, discussions like this, workshops, challenges, hands-on demonstrations. And Harvard programs in the course of that have explored pathways not only in civic engagement and reimagined uses of the arts, but in particular here, advances within life sciences. And so we're very happy and pleased to have been able to contribute to that. To give you a little background, the Stem Cell Institute is a collaborative of more than 1,000 scientists and physicians dedicated across the Harvard and hospital system to harnessing the power of stem cells to advance scientific and medical breakthroughs. With a somewhat unique business model of part research institute, part venture capitalist, we're trying to advance a study of diseases, whether particular ones such as diabetes, ALS, Parkinson's, and others, or processes such as aging and repair, where we believe stem cell biology is essential to bringing new treatments and understanding disease. Tonight, we have an exceptional panel with us who each study aging from very different perspectives. Thanks to their work, there are new prospects for understanding and managing the process of aging and age-related diseases. But to lead that discussion, we're even happier to have STAT's Sharon Begley with us. Sharon is a senior science writer at STAT. She covers genetics, cancer, neuroscience, and other fields of basic biomedical research. She was previously the senior health and science correspondent at Reuters, science columnist at the Wall Street Journal, and science editor at Newsweek. So she not only knows what she's talking about, but what everyone else on the panel is talking about. Sharon.
Thank you very much, Brock. And let me add my own welcome to Brock's. Thank you so much for all turning out on a Friday evening. I am Sharon Begley. And for those of you who have not yet encountered STAT, we are the life sciences publication launched only last year by the owner of the Boston Globe, John Henry, who is better known for owning something else up here. But I'm from New York, so I'm not going to talk about that. And he just saw an unmet need for more in-depth and broader coverage of the life sciences here. As Brock said, I cover basic biomedical research for the most part, and that goes across fields from oncology to neuroscience and genetics to aging. So welcome to Ageless Aging. You have in your handouts the full biographies of our speakers for this evening, so let me give you just the brief version. And I'm going to take it in the order in which they are going to come up here and give you a brief introduction to their work and the general topic. We'll first hear from William Mayer. He is assistant professor of genetics and complex diseases at the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health. Then Amy Wagers, the Forced Family Professor of Stem Cell and Regenerative Biology at Harvard. She is also an executive committee member at the Harvard Stem Cell Institute. Rich Lee is Professor of Stem Cell and Regenerative Biology at Harvard and a leader of the cardiovascular program at the Harvard Stem Cell Institute. Tracy Young Pierce is Assistant Professor of Neurology at Brigham and Women's Hospital and Harvard Med School and a principal faculty member at the Harvard Stem Cell Institute. Last but not least will be Paola Sebastiani, a professor of biostatistics at Boston University School of Public Health. So we will follow a fairly standard format. As I said, each of the speakers will stand where I am standing and give you a brief introduction to their work. And at the end, we will have a magical appearance of five chairs, and they will come up here and be available to answer. I'll start off with some questions, but we strongly encourage you guys to ask questions as well. And the way we're going to do that is members of the staff have given you, I hope, or are available. You have note cards. So as the speakers say something that intrigues you or puzzles you or just begs for a follow-up question, which you can't count on me to ask, just scribble down what you would like to ask and do something like this. And again, one of the staff members will collect it, bring it to me, and I will get to as many as we can, which I think will be a lot. We have an hour and a half, and the speakers are going to tell you only the teeniest little bit about their work, so there will be a great deal more that we can draw them out about. So without further ado, let me ask Bill Mayer of the Harvard T.H. Chan School to come up and tell us about his work.
Okay, it's a real pleasure to be here. I've just come from an aging research meeting in New York. It's much more fun to talk to the public. You pay for the research, after all. So I'd like to talk to you a bit about the genetics of aging as a field. So in the 20th century, we did an amazing job at making humans live a lot longer. This is the years of life. This is life expectancy in 1900 and at the end of that century. So in 100 years, we added something like 27 years to the chance of living for everyone. And that was really doing nothing to slow our aging rates. That was really all public health. That was things like sanitation, vaccination, education, things which really alleviated some of the things which killed us when we were young and enabled us all to live to a long time. So this is a really great, amazing thing we've done to human populations. We're surviving a lot longer and getting the chance to age in huge numbers that we never did before. And if you actually look at those numbers, this is not just a disease of the rich. This is happening across the globe and it's still happening. If you project it forward, the numbers of people that are surviving over 65 in the next sort of 50 years, you have this really striking number that by 2050, we expect worldwide to be 1.5 billion people over the age of 65. So the current population of China will be over, well, not all in China, obviously, but worldwide will be over 65. So this is really the great news that we're doing a great job at surviving a lot longer. However, of course, there's a problem with that. So really, when you think about it, by enabling us to live a lot longer, we've uncovered all these diseases that we get in our elderly years that we didn't get before. So this is really a central key point of the field, is that age, patient age, is the biggest risk factor for nearly every chronic disease you can think of. This is just some kind of more famous ones lined up on the right here, things like cardiovascular disease, cancer, Alzheimer's, neurological disorders. You're more likely to get those when you're old than when you're young. So age is really a central risk factor for all these different disease burdens. So in some ways you could argue we're getting these diseases because we're now not dying when we're younger, we're living long enough to see these diseases. So then what can we do to try and make those healthy years that we've added to our lives, the extra years we've added, really healthy? And there's different ways to approach that. So a medical approach is to try and understand really what's causing every one of those different disease types, understand the mechanisms and try and develop therapeutics and drugs which will alleviate each one of those diseases in turn. So you're effectively putting out the fire as it arises. And this is a really great way of doing research. It's how we set up the National Institutes of Health. We have an institute for cancer, an institute for diabetes. However, I think there is one problem with that. And the problem really is that the way we get diseases when we're old is very different from the types of ways we get diseases when we're young. The things that were killing us in the 20th century in our teens and later on were individual diseases. If you could cure those diseases, the patient would survive and live a healthy life. However, in our elderly years, you get multiple different comorbidities at once. And this is illustrated here. If you look on this left-hand panel here, these are different age-related disorders. And this tiny fragment, this sliver of blue down the left-hand side, are the percentage of patients that have one of those diseases and only have that disease. In fact, when you're over 65, you tend to have multiple different comorbidities, 2, 3, 4 different diseases, where age is a risk factor for all of them, but the cause of those diseases is actually different. So this leaves us kind of with a problem, is that if you were to get rid of one of those diseases completely by some medical therapeutic, sadly you're left with all the other comorbidities in old age. So if you illustrate life in a very simple term here, this is just a green bar of any animal or human.
the years you spend healthy and green, and then you get disease one, disease two, disease three, and disease four. If you take the medical approach and you cure one altogether, this is really what you do to that line. You might increase lifespan a bit, you might increase the length of that green bar a little bit, but you'll still get those different diseases that will still ultimately cause morbidity in old age. So something that my lab does and my field does is try and take a more public health sort of preventative approach. Is there a way we can think about, instead of those diseases in isolation, aging itself, the underlying risk factor? Can we understand why age is a risk factor more generally for diseases? And can we target aging itself for broad disease therapeutics? And so if you could do that, what might that look like? It could look like lots of different things. Maybe you would just stretch this green bar. A patient will live a lot longer healthily, but eventually they would still suffer those different morbidities, still spend a lot of time in this sort of red and orange period here, and then eventually pass away later on. Or maybe we could do this. So in fact, there are human populations. Some of us are very fortunate to live to 100. And some of those centenarian populations, as we'll hear about, don't spend an even stretched period of time in a morbid state. In fact, they live very healthy into their late 90s and often then kind of fail very quickly at the end to recompress this period of morbidity. And so could we find modifications that did that? And maybe that wouldn't even increase lifespan at all. And we'll hear some of these things later from the other speakers. This is really the goal. Can we think about aging and increase this period of healthy life, not just the number of years we live? And so hopefully you're a skeptical Boston audience, and you're sitting there going, this guy's just saying he can cure all diseases instead of one disease. Why is that even possible? That surely can't be possible. And so the reason I want to kind of implore with you that this may be possible, we're beginning to try and find ways to do this, is really because of this fact, that there are conserved mechanisms, there are pathways and genes within our genomes which regulate aging in different systems, different species across the kind of evolutionary spectra. So from simple organisms like fruit flies and nematode worms that live in the soil, right up to mammals and people. And so this is one example of this. This is some work done in the 90s, not by my lab, although we work on this gene, of a mutation found in the nematode worm C. elegans. And this was really the first example of a gene which, if you just tweaked its function, can make an animal live a lot longer. And this is a really striking phenotype. This is, you could do one thing to a gene and slow the aging process, but it was in a nematode worm. But importantly, it didn't just make those animals live a long time. They lived really healthily. So if you look at this video here of a nematode worm, this is at day 13 or so, so early on. This is a wild-type animal. It ages. Its skin wrinkles, it gets senescent, it looks kind of weak, and eventually it dies after 2 or 3 weeks. And so it really ages in a way that humans age, and then it passes away. However, this long-lived red line here, this mutant animal which lives 60 days instead of 25 days, that's what this looks like at the same age. So this mutant not only lives much longer, it lives twice as long, but it lives very healthily. It spends a lot of its time in a youthful state and doing much better. So this was really a striking experiment that said it was possible to slow aging rate more generally and protect against sort of the dysfunction we see in old age. However, of course, we don't care about making worms live a long time. My goal as a researcher, I work at Harvard School of Public Health. I wouldn't have a position there if I could just make worms live a long time, or at least if that's what I was trying to do. What was really exciting is that from the end of the 90s and through the last 15, 20 years, is that that same gene which made a worm live a long time was then shown to make a fruit fly live a long time. If you modulated that same gene, now a very different animal that lives a very different life would also live a lot longer. Not only that, if we did the same mutation in a mouse, and now we're getting more and more like people as we move up this evolutionary ladder, you can mutate just one gene in a mouse, and now that mouse would live a lot longer and its aging rate was slowed. But also, if you looked at those mice, they were much more youthful. So this is two mice from this study here, one the normal wild-type animal in black that's looking old, it gets gray hair, it gets cancer, it gets different age-related diseases. And then this one on the right here has just had one mutation to one gene. It lives a lot longer, but it doesn't get cancer at the same time. If you give it an Alzheimer's model, it doesn't get cognitive decline at the same rate. So you can really have an effect on multiple different diseases with one intervention. So this is really a striking kind of pattern that's come in the last 15, 20 years, is there are ways to modulate the aging rate across different species. We can learn about mammalian aging by studying these basic systems. But of course, we don't care about mice either. This is the really big question, which the other people on the panel will talk to you about. Will these basic science of aging help human age-related disorders? And what's exciting now is with the advances in technology and the getting much, much more cheap to kind of sequence genomes, we can now study those human populations, and you'll hear about this later, that live really well and age really well. This is an example of Faroe Singh, who ran a marathon at 100 years old. So he's a centenarian and a very healthy centenarian. And what we can now do is study the genotypes of those people that do very well and now ask, are the things linked in their genome which are describing why they're doing very well? And really excitingly, what we found is that, lo and behold, some of the same genes which we made a worm live a long time, and here this insulin IGF signaling pathway, were found to have mutations in human centenarians. So in fact, you can completely complete this loop and find, from the genetics in simple systems, we can understand genes linked to extreme longevity in human populations. And now we can go backwards and forwards, back between these different systems and understand aging. So this is really what the conserved genetics of aging field is, that we can look at aging itself rather than specific diseases and try and understand how we can modulate those processes. Just one last slide, I'll talk to you a bit very briefly about what my lab does. Some of you have probably heard about this phenomenon of dietary restriction, this sense that if you restrict the amount of food different model species and different animals eat, they live a long time. Whether they're living in a happy state is a question we can all talk about, but they live a long time. And we want to understand how that happens and if we can get the effects of dietary restriction without having to eat less food. And so we work on this protein called AMBK, which doesn't matter really what it stands for, but AMBK is a fuel sensor in all of your cells and all the cells in a nematode worm and a fruit fly, so that when you eat less food, this thing is turned on and it then modulates a lot of pathways in your bodies. And what we've showed in our lab is if you make a version of this fuel sensor, which now can't sense energy, and it always thinks, effectively, there isn't any food around, and then you put that into a nematode worm, now you can increase lifespan and slow aging by basically mimicking the effects of dietary restriction. So these animals eat a normal amount of food, but we've tweaked this fuel sensor so they think they're eating less, and now their aging rate is slowed. And so we're doing a lot of work here, some of the papers at the bottom, to understand how that's happening and if we can mimic that in different systems. And so with that, this is really my take-home message, that the field of aging research is not about the fountain of youth. This isn't the reason we work on aging research, or at least it's not the reason I do. It's really because public health enabled us to live a long time in the last 100 years. But what it's given us is an extended period of time that we live in an unhealthy state. So really the challenge is to find ways to make those extra years healthy ones. And this is what you'll hear about from the other speakers on the panel. So with that, this is the great team that I work with over the other side of the river that work in my lab, the young team, and I'm really fortunate to work with them. And these are my funding sources, and I'll take question. Any question? Thank you.
For everyone toward the end. And I just wanted to mention four questions. If you are more comfortable with your thumbs than writing on the note card, you can also use Twitter to submit questions. And to do that, the hashtag is HSCIHub, as in Harvard Stem Cell Institute Hub. And we will look at those as the evening goes on. So let me now ask Amy Wagers to come up and tell us about her work.
So thanks very much. Thanks to you all for being here today to talk about aging. So you, as you've just heard from Will, aging is the single biggest risk factor for many chronic degenerative diseases. And this fact, coupled with the observation that Will already mentioned, that the world's elderly population has increased in dramatic fashion over the last century, has given rise to really an explosion in research into the basic mechanisms, causes, and etiologies of age-related dysfunction. So there's a recognition that aging is a prominent global health and medical research issue, which has led really to this rapid increase in the number of publications on aging that one can pull out of the scientific literature. And what this has told us is that, in fact, aging is not just an inexorable process of wear and tear that's essentially unmanipulable, but actually aging is subject to manipulable genetic and biochemical controls, and that this process, as Will already mentioned, can be slowed, and in some cases, even reversed. So what is it that all this work on aging biology has told us about the process of aging? So first is that it's identified several hallmarks of changes in the biological systems that actually seem to underwrite these processes and lead to the development of the characteristics that we understand to be aging. One key aspect is a gradual degradation or damage to cellular constituents, to the basic building blocks of cells, such as DNA, lipids, and proteins, which leads to an inability of cells to function as effectively. Proteins appear to be particularly important in this, and there's a diminution in the quality control mechanisms in cells that normally make effective proteins that are necessary for cellular function. The ways that cells communicate with one another also changes as organisms age, and this affects the ability of the body to time and coordinate important biological and physiological processes. In tissues, the regenerative function, the ability of cells and of tissues and organs to recover after injury seems to decline with age, and this reflects a change in the resident stem cell and progenitor cell populations, which normally support the repair of these organs. Throughout the body, you see an increase in the overall level of inflammation, mediated in part by the emergence of so-called senescent cells. These are cells found throughout the body that exit the cell cycle, so they're no longer dividing, but they continue to be metabolically active and to secrete proteins that can affect the functioning of nearby cells and promote this tone of inflammation that actually suppresses proper cellular function. There are changes in metabolism, particularly a change in appropriate nutrient sensing, disruption of energy production in subcellular organelles known as mitochondria, and a change in the way that energy is produced and stored that actually deregulates the ability of the body to take in and utilize energy. And then finally, the genome itself becomes unstable, with changes that lead to alterations that impair cellular function and mutate DNA. And so, importantly, these hallmarks of aging affect not just one cell or two cells or a few cells in the body, but they're seen throughout the body, and they interact with one another in interesting ways that suggest, as Will alluded to already, that in trying to develop therapeutics that actually effectively target age-related disorders, it may be possible to take a different approach rather than focusing on individual diseases individually, that we could actually take aim at the underlying mechanisms of aging that actually lead to the predisposition to these types of disorders as individuals become older. And the good news is that there's some evidence from scientific literature that actually suggests that this strategy holds some merit. And there's even some aspects of this that include behavioral activities that you could do today. So ongoing research suggests that there are, in fact, common mechanisms that underlie age-related pathologies, and that at least some of these can be reversed even in already aged organisms. As I mentioned, some are quite simple behavioral modifications. Will already mentioned the importance of low-calorie diet and the fact that that has been shown to improve healthy aging in a large number of different organ systems. Exercise also, very important, and improves the functionality in skeletal muscle, in the heart, in the brain, and probably other organs. There are also potential interventions which have been tested in rodent and invertebrate models, but whose efficacy in humans and other higher organisms remains to be established. These include reactivation of the enzyme telomerase, which adds sequence to the ends of chromosomes and protects them from damage, and has been shown to have beneficial effects in the brain and skeletal muscle. Activation of a class of proteins known as sirtuins, which coordinate metabolism with cell stress and defense pathways. And these activation of these proteins have been important, shown to be important in ameliorating the effects of aging in skeletal muscle and fat. Ablation of those senescent cells I mentioned earlier that sort of raise the inflammatory tone in older organs, and that the removal of these cells has been demonstrated to extend lifespan in mice and actually to improve functionality in the fat, in the skeletal muscle, and in the eye. And then finally, a model system that my laboratory has worked on extensively called heterochronic parabiosis, which is a system in which one can test for the effects of substances that circulate in the blood in order to alter the physiology of aged tissues. And so in this system, one can expose the cells and organs of an older animal to blood factors and blood substances that are normally found only in youth. And this powerful model has actually provided a really strong evidence to argue that inter-organ communication through signals that are sent through the bloodstream is actually a very important coordinating event in maintaining tissue physiology that becomes disruptive with age. And if one can rebalance that through the provision of more youthful signals from the blood in this heterochronic parabiosis system, that actually can have beneficial effects in a large number of tissues and organs, including organs that vary quite dramatically in their normal physiology and the normal ways that they function, and in their normal capacity to repair themselves after injury. Interestingly, studies in this system have shown that the sort of reversibility of aging characteristics and across different organ systems can vary quite a lot. But in those tissues that respond very strongly to these signals in young blood, one can see a so-called rejuvenation or restoration of function that affects both the ability of the tissues to repair themselves and actually remodels them so that they function better in the steady state. And so what should be obvious from these discussions is that if one could actually figure out mechanistically and molecularly what these substances in the blood are, they would provide really exciting novel therapies to try to target root causes of dysfunction in age-related disease. And this is an ongoing effort in a large number of laboratories, and so far has uncovered only a handful of factors, including positively acting factors that seem to be lost with age and can be provided from a young blood circulation, as well as negatively acting factors that seem to build up with age and suppress tissue function. And you're going to hear more about one of these molecules, GDF11, which we've worked on extensively from Rich Lee in the subsequent talk, which we're excited about because it seems to have effects across different organ systems, suggesting that this may be a factor that coordinates aging in different systems. And so what I hope to leave you with then is the notion that it's of critical importance to develop new therapeutic strategies to combat age-related diseases, which are a current, critical, expanding, and unmet public health issue. And in order to do that, it will be critical to understand more about the basic and fundamental biology of aging, as well as the emergence of age-related diseases, because these are the pillars upon which any new therapeutics would be built. And in that sense, I want to leave you with a plea to please help us support aging research. I know that the advances that we've seen over the last 20 years would not have been possible without the strong support of biomedical science. And as you probably know, one of the major supporters of research in biomedicine, and particularly aging, is the government through the National Institutes on Aging. And this is the budget of the NIA, and I know that these numbers seem quite large, but if you calculate this out, at the highest level of funding at the NIA, which was in the year 2014, the average cost per year per US citizen was only $3.67. So you can skip a Starbucks and fund the NIA. But the other important aspect to take away from this chart is actually that over the last 15 years or so, the budget for the NIA has been flat. And so that means in real dollars, the NIA has lost significant funding power of almost 15% over the last 15 years. And the effects of this belt tightening are really that fewer meritorious proposals are funded, less research is done, and progress towards real therapies is slowed. And so while the effects of this are clearly delayed, I think they're already beginning to be felt, because for the first time now in its history, in recent years, the number of aging publications published per year is actually going down, and it's projected to go down again this year. And this doesn't mean that the problem is solved. It actually reflects the exit of people from the field, a reduced funding for those who remain, and a slowing of progress in the research. And so I very much hope that events like tonight are helpful in helping everyone understand the importance of this kind of research, the impact that it can have, and the real importance of pushing forward to develop a better understanding of aging and a better approach to treating age-related diseases. And this is my goal and my lab's goal, and I know the goal of all of my colleagues who are here tonight. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Amy. And we will now hear from Rich Lee.
You know, I'm going to start, actually, $3.67 doesn't sound much, but we've actually gotten some pretty good benefits from our healthcare research over the past half century. And so this is really to show you something that I think Americans should be proud of. Franklin Roosevelt, over half a century ago, has a stroke from hypertension and dies, and the National Heart Institute was formed, and the NIH starts to take off. And so here we are, over half a century, all benefiting from the work that was done over the past half century. This is heart disease in males. There's deaths in the US per 100,000 people. And you can see that over the past 20 or 30 years, it's been steadily decreasing, really at an amazing rate. It's been less of an effect in females, but it's still going down. And really, we've made a dramatic impact on females over the past decade as well. If you look, these are cancer rates in males, and these are cancer rates in females. And so for most of our lives, as I look around, the rates of heart disease were way above, taking lives were way above the rates for cancer. And now they're about the same. cancer has been about the same, but we really have made dramatic progress. And that really is research that's done that. We've learned so much about prevention and treatment of heart disease. But as the population grows older, more patients with heart disease, and so the problem's still enormous, and for the next century, heart disease will still be the worldwide number one killer. So a really fascinating thing has happened over this past 20 or 30 years. When most of us were born, this was what heart failure was. Heart attacks destroyed parts of the heart, and the heart grows big and baggy, and it doesn't beat. And if any of you ever saw Dr. Zhivago, the movie, this is what Dr. Zhivago dropped dead of with Laura just a few feet away from him. So that was classic heart failure for the past century. And nowadays, because we're so good at treating this, we actually have much more of a different kind of heart failure that has emerged because the population is aging, and also because of diabetes and obesity. But now most of the patients that we have with heart failure don't have big, baggy, dilated hearts. They have hearts that pump actually pretty well, but they can't fill well because they're thick and stiff. And so it's a new form of heart failure. This is now the most common cause of admission to cardiology services in the United States and other countries like England. So we've been very interested in this problem, and we have literally a dozen great treatments for the old style of heart failure, but we have none for this new style of heart failure. So I've been working with Dr. Wagers on looking for something that could potentially reset the heart back to a younger age. And so I won't tell you this work is complete by any means, but there's a factor that we believe that we can give to old mice, and in a relatively short period of time, it can make an old heart look like a young heart. That doesn't mean that it's going to look like that forever, but it's an effect that we think has been quite compelling. Now, even more important than that is that one of my colleagues, when he heard about this, started looking for this protein in humans. And this is a study that he did. It's a friend of mine named Peter Gans, who's at UCSF. He looked at blood that he collected in patients in California, and he'd followed the patients for the next decade. And he said, well, if this actually can potentially prevent heart failure in mice, then perhaps it can actually do something like that in humans. And he had blood collected from a decade ago. So he had all this data on around 900 patients. And you can see that if you have low levels, that's quartile one in red, of this protein in blood, that you're much more likely to have heart failure, you're more likely to have death. And he wasn't satisfied with this. He's a very careful person. So he went to Europe and found investigators who had a similar, almost 1,000 patients who had followed patients for over 5 years. And you can see that he found the same thing, that if you have low levels of this protein in blood, then you're much more likely to die and you're much more likely to have heart failure. So we're very excited about this because you can find a lot of things in mice in the laboratory. But when you have human data that looks like this, it's really worth going after. And we think with another few months of research, we'll have identified exactly what this factor is in human blood. And then we can begin to think, how can we actually turn that around and do something that's potentially beneficial for patients? And so this is, I think, what a lot of us are interested in. If you ask most Americans, how long do you want to live? And we're getting around 79 or 80 years old. The average American says that they want to live until they're about 90, but they want to feel really good until they're about 90. If you have to ask teenagers, they say 78 is fine, right? Right? So they're the wrong group to ask. But the average American thinks about 90. The average American does not think that we should live to 120 years. They don't think that that's a good idea. But they want another decade or so beyond what we're getting now. And even more importantly, as you heard already, we want to feel good for those last 10 to 20 years. We don't want to feel bad and live another 20 or 30 years in that state. So what we think is that there are certain things in us that we can potentially look for that can fill this gap so that we can live a little longer than we're living, but also live a little bit better. So, thank you.
Thank you very much, Rich. And now we will hear from Tracy Young Pierce.
All right, thank you so much. So I'm going to talk about aging in the brain, and specifically I'm going to talk about a very devastating disorder of aging, Alzheimer's disease. And this is what my lab studies. We try to understand the underlying basis for Alzheimer's disease and try to identify new targets for therapeutic interventions. Here I'm showing, so we all age differently in terms of aging in the brain. This is a graph showing age along the x-axis and cognitive status. And you can see that some people have a very sharp decline in cognitive status here in just 5 years, whereas other people can live quite a long time and have a relatively stable level of cognitive abilities and memory. However, in terms of that, those people that decline very rapidly, a large contribution of this is due to the onset of Alzheimer's disease. And Alzheimer's is one of those very specific diseases that, of course, aging is a very is the greatest risk factor for Alzheimer's. And this line really highlights this point. So there's an early onset form of the disease that can happen at age 50, 40, and even 30. But the majority of Alzheimer's disease occurs very late. And you can see this as the percent of the population with AD, you can see, or Alzheimer's disease, you can see that there's this inflection point at age 70 where we really increase risk quite a bit up until age 80. You all know, I'm sure, because it's so prevalent, you all know probably know someone with Alzheimer's disease or have been affected by Alzheimer's in some way. And we know that it's due, the phenotype of Alzheimer's disease is a loss of memory and cognitive ability. But in the lab, what we try to understand is what happens before that occurs that leads to the disease. I mean, if you put an Alzheimer's disease brain next to a healthy brain of similar age, you can see that there is a massive loss of volume here. And there's overt degeneration of the brain. So the neurons, the cells of the brain that are communicating with one another, are dying quite dramatically at advanced Alzheimer's. But even before you have the death of these neurons, you have the accumulation of these pathological hallmarks shown here. So in brown, we can stain in the lab for these sticky plaques that we call A-beta plaques, because they consist of A-beta. And these accumulate in the brain well before overt death. And we also have tangles composed of this hyperphosphorylated tau protein. So these two pathological hallmarks that occur late in disease, actually we see signs of these very early on before symptoms occur. And we're trying to understand who is going to develop these plaques and tangles and who is going to be affected by them so that we can intervene very early with new therapeutics and try to prevent the overt death that's seen here. Because if we wait until the cells have died to treat, it's going to be very difficult to try to regain function or even to maintain cognitive ability. So in my lab, like as I said, we tried to understand the underlying causes. And to do that, one of the ways we do this is we use stem cells from human patients, because this was originally funded by the Harvard Stem Cell Institute. We're able to take stem cells from patients and turn them into brain cells in a dish, and then try to use those brain cells in a dish as a proxy for what's happening within the human population. So here I have what I told you in the very first slide, which is that there's this spectrum of pathology and cognitive ability with age. And so while some people have a very dramatic cognitive decline with lots of amyloid plaques and tangles, other people have no plaques or tangles in their brain and can maintain their cognition well into their 100s. And this, while many people fall in these two categories, there's actually a spectrum. And so there are many people who actually have a high level of amyloid plaques, but do not have any cognitive decline. And this is a very interesting population for us to study, because if we can try to figure out why are these people protected from this very devastating, these devastating plaques, we might be able to then develop new therapies to try to protect these people who do show cognitive decline. So to do this, my lab uses multiple models, but something that we're doing right now that I wanted to talk about briefly is we're trying to generate stem cells from this spectrum of people, and we need to really understand the mechanisms of this. We need to do this from many different people. So we're doing this from over 50 different individuals, where basically we have sets of people that we followed for many, many years, and this is in collaboration with many other groups, where we can follow, we have people who have come, volunteers who have come in every single year for a battery of 12 different cognitive tests. They all enter cognitively normal, and they're followed for over the past 20 or 30 years. We can get these, and so by following them every year, we can figure out what their projection is for their cognitive abilities. At death, they've consented to donate their brains, and we can then look at within their brains to see if what level of plaques and tangles they have. And in parallel, from these exact same subjects, we can take a sample of blood, turn this blood into stem cells, and these stem cells are remarkable because they can divide infinitely, and we have an unlimited supply, and we can direct them to become cells of the brain. We then have the cells in a dish that we can study mechanisms of Alzheimer's disease and see, from the same patient, would we be able to have predicted which of the patients would have developed plaques and tangles and which would have responded to these plaques and tangles by having Alzheimer's disease. More importantly, though, perhaps, and something that I'm very excited about with this potential that has the potential of this system to actually test new therapeutics to see if who would respond to them and who would not respond to them. So you may have heard in the news there's a new trial from Biogen for an antibody that looks very promising for Alzheimer's disease. And this antibody actually targets that A-beta protein, that amyloid protein that makes the plaques that I told you about. We have assays in place where we would like to try to test, of the 50 people we have, which of their cells would respond to that antibody treatment. We think that we will be able to identify a subset that will respond and a subset that won't respond, and then we want to use the same system to try to develop novel therapies and novel antibodies to try to address the problem in more people. So with that, I just wanted to leave you with a slide from the NIH website, the National Institutes of Health website, on tips for healthy brain aging. And the reason I wanted to end with this is that while we believe that much of the risk for Alzheimer's disease is encoded genetically, intrinsically in our cells, there are things that every one of us can do to try to make our brains as healthy as possible and to try to reduce our risk of Alzheimer's disease. And these are all points that all we scientists in the field agree do make a difference. And so one of those relates to what many of the others have told, what Bill talked about in the very first slide, in terms of comorbidities. And it's very true that if you can control other aspects of your health beyond just your brain health, this will impact your risk for Alzheimer's disease. So if you can keep your body healthy, it'll help you keep your brain healthy. In addition, in regular exercise, physical exercise, as well as intellectual exercise, also has been experimentally proven to help in decrease risk. And eating a healthy diet, it also does make a difference. So in my final slide, I just want to thank our funding agencies, especially HSCI, who really allowed us to begin to use stem cells to look at Alzheimer's disease. And I want to thank you all for listening.
Thank you so much, Tracy. And last but not least, we will hear from Paola Sebastiani and her amazing centenarians.
Thank you very much for having me here. And I'm going to conclude. I'm the last presenter. And I'm going to conclude, I hope, in a happy tone. And rather than talking about diseases and the negative aspect of aging, we can actually see people who age in an extremely well way. And the message here would be,
sorry. I thought he turned that off. I'm sorry.
It wasn't me. So the message, the take-home message will be that centenarians, the longer they live, the healthier they have been. And so I start with some pictures. The woman who has lived the longest documented life in the world is Madame Calmant. She was a French woman who died at the age of 122. Now, in this picture, she was shown at the year in which she died. And of course, she looks old, but she was, you know, 122, and that's what you expect. She was almost blind, but she was physically well enough to participate to a documentary. And so there was an attempt to have a documentary that about her and about this extreme age that she reached. Now, what is interesting, though, is to look at her when she was a little younger. And by a little younger, I mean when she was 116. And this picture, actually, there is a little bit of controversy. Maybe this picture was taken when she was 113. But still, these are really remarkable ages. And what I am a statistician. I'm not a geriatrician. But what I'm working with Tom Pearls, I've learned is when you look at this picture, what is remarkable is first how she's engaged with the photographer. And again, at this really old age. And the other thing that is really remarkable is how she sits, how the muscle strength that she still has at this remarkable age. Now, the longest lived woman in the United States is Sarah Knaus. She died at the age of 119. This picture was taken, I took this picture from the Times Magazine. The Times Magazine published the article the year she died. And there is a famous picture in that article that shows Sarah Knaus with six living generations. And this little boy is, if I remember correctly, is the great-great-great-great-grandchild of this woman. And again, she looks old. But when we look at her a few years before, age 99, the way she looked was really remarkable. And so when we look at centenarians, the reason we look at centenarians is not so much as a way to extend lifespan, but because a lot of centenarians have this feature, that they've lived a very long life, but they have compressed morbidity and disability to the very end of their life. And so one of the things that we have shown, I work with Tom Pearls, who's the director of the New England Centenarian Study, and in the course of 20 years, he has enrolled 2,000 centenarians. Now he says that centenarians are actually becoming common, and so he's become very picky, and he only enrolls individuals who have reached the age of 105 and older. And then he has managed to enroll almost 200 individuals who live past the age of 110. And what we have managed to show with this incredible cohort is this phenomenon of compression of morbidity. This has been a hypothesis that was formulated in the 80s, and the idea was that for people to live long, they have to compress morbidity and disability to the end. And the idea was the age cutoff back then was 100. What we realize is that we really have to look at much older people to see this phenomenon of compression of morbidity. We have to look at individuals who live to 110 and older to see this incredibly extended lifespan together with health span. And just to make an example, if you look at cardiovascular disease, which is the number one killer in older people, by the age of 77, about a quarter of the population who has reached that age has had a cardiovascular event. In super centenarians, so individuals who live past the age of 110, this age is 103 years. So you can think at this almost 25 years that you gain of healthy life, which is the goal. We want to understand how we can keep people healthy as they age. So then the big question is, what have we learned? How do we do this? It seems cool. How do we do this? Well, genetics is a major contributor to the this extreme lifespan and extreme health span. So we have identified, as other presenters mentioned before, We have identified genes that allow people to reach very extreme ages. They allow individuals to compress disability and morbidity to the end of their lives. And so we might not fully understand the biology, the mechanism that allow people to accomplish these goals, but we understand genetics as a major role. So we know the answer to our question, what do we need to have in order to live long and healthy? We need to choose our parents very well, which is not an easy thing to do. It's impossible. But we inherit our genes from our parents, and so there is nothing we can do about it. So the work we are doing now is focused on this goal. The goal is how we can translate the findings from human genetics, how we can translate them into interventions that can be applied to the general population and help them remain healthy as they age. And the idea is this is an incredibly difficult problem. The more we work, the more we realize, my God, this is really hard to resolve. But we have to be able to link genetic data to molecular data and collaborate together, especially manage to have collaborations with epidemiologists, basic scientists, et cetera, to really understand what are the you can think of the molecular environment that is created from these particular genetic variants that can help people stay healthy as they age. And I will conclude here. Thank you. And I stay here, right? Yeah.
Okay, you're all sitting behind your name signs. Thank you very much. Let me just start off and ask, I think Will, and probably Pella, but maybe even all of you, if you could tell us the connection, the relationship between ageless aging and the absence or postponement of morbidity slash disease. In other words, are they synonymous? Is the absence or postponement of disease necessary but not sufficient for ageless aging, or none of the above? Maybe, Will, would you mind tackling that?
So I can re-sum up your question. Do you need the bad things to get the good things sort of thing? So I think for a long time, if we think about something like dietary restriction, which can make an animal in a lab live a long time, it does a lot of negative things to the animal in that lab too. So it's a small animal, its reproduction is down, it lives in a germ-free environment. If it didn't, it wouldn't do very well because it has immune depression. And so we really thought that you needed those bad things almost to be able to shift those resources to the good things, and you couldn't do both at the same time. And I think in the last 5 or 10 years now, we've got examples in basic science that you actually can, through either tweaking genetics or through tweaking diet in particular, kind of have an intervention which prolongs lifespan and maintains growth and maintains high reproductive capacity. And so really the question is, can we do that from a medical point of view to people? Will we be able to kind of really increase the kind of vitality right into old age? And so I think the answer is, if you'd asked me as a graduate student in 2002, I would have said probably not. But having just come back from a meeting, I think there are examples now where we can. So I think potentially we will be able to find interventions which can maintain this sort of really square the curve of mortality distribution to maintain health and old age.
Paula, is there anything about the centenarians beyond? I mean, you showed how they're basically okay, and then, as you said, compressed morbidity at the end of life. Is there anything you've learned from studying them that speaks to the question of whether aging is more than the absence of morbidity, of disease? Or the opposite, if postponing aging, ageless aging is the absence of disease?
So I think what we see in many centenarians, not all of them, but many centenarians, is that it is possible to age well. It is possible to age postponing disease or avoiding disease, but postponing disease to the very end. It is possible to have postpone the decline of cognitive and physical functions. I think the concept of ageless aging for me is that there is a lot of negative connotation about aging, but aging is a biological process. Aging is not bad or good. Aging is aging. It's something that happens. And what we can do is try to age well we don't reverse aging, but we can try to maintain our physical function, our cognitive function well, and do the best we can. But I think it's important for me, and it's important that something we have really learned from centenarians, that you don't want to look at aging as a, I don't like to hear aging is the major risk factor of diseases. Aging, they happen together. We shouldn't think of aging as a negative thing, or curing disease, avoid the risk for disease by reversing aging. So to me, that's a very important concept to.
Rich, you and actually others underlined the difference between lifespan and healthspan. So one of the sort of questions I had as each of you were talking is, so cardiovascular, brain, lots of systems. Do you think that there is even a single master aging controller thing happening? And Will, you mentioned, several of you mentioned some of the genetic components, such that if we did something there, then the consequences would be seen throughout physiological systems? Or is aging in the brain going to be different from aging in the cardiovascular system, and on and on?
It's a theoretical question, I think. Everyone would like to have one single pill that can that can give us that.
They'll be in the back of the room later.
10 or 12 years. And there are people who believe that something that like that might be possible. But it's also quite possible that it would do it for some people, but not for others, and it would cause problems, or it would benefit some systems and not benefit others. I don't think we know enough yet to really be sure about it. It obviously is a modifiable process, and it's one that we can actually have some input in from the types of things that we do.
Amy, anything on that? Health span, lifespan, the distinction?
Sure. I think that in terms of, you know, is there a magic pill? I think we definitely don't have one, and I think it's unlikely that such would exist. But in terms of the commonality of underlying processes, I think it's been demonstrated across organisms and across organ systems that common processes are perturbed, and so there's the possibility that building on that framework, one can identify a handful of biological mechanisms whose targeting could be beneficial, maybe not across all systems in the body, but at least across a proportion of them, so that at least some characteristics of aging could be commonly targeted.
So, Tracy, how might that work in the brain? As you showed us, age is the crucial risk factor for Alzheimer's. Does it seem that whatever underlying aging processes are going on there is specifically triggering the physiological cellular changes in Alzheimer's, or is that a separate
thing? So there's two different things here that I'll say about that. One is that, as I mentioned, there is this very early onset form of Alzheimer's disease that looks exactly like late onset, but it happens in your 30s or 40s. And there is no other concomitant aging process happening. But as we've been talking about, there are a lot of comorbid problems with Alzheimer's disease. And it's also known that with Alzheimer's disease, your rate of decline will be much more steep if you have another stress on the body. So some other, that could be induced by aging, or it could be, or something like a stroke, or even a gastrointestinal problem can also accelerate your rate of cognitive decline. So I think these systems are so intimately linked that when I hear Amy and Rich talking about GDF-11 as something that can help the heart, I can't help but say, I'd love to see how that would look in Alzheimer's disease. Mm-hmm. Even though when you first asked, is there one factor that's going to affect everything, my first thing is no. No, but that, in spite of that, I hear about something that affects the heart aging, and I want to look in the brain.
Mm-hmm. Who thinks that there is a natural upper limit to the human lifespan? I think we have 122 years over on the far right. Is that basically it, or might there be any interventions, despite people wanting to live to no more than 90, as Rich told us? Is that
122 just the way it is now, or might we push that even a few years or decades higher? Anybody who wants to jump in?
There's been a lot of discussion about people who are born now who will live to 300, 400 years. But I think what we have learned so far is to reach those ages, 122, we haven't seen any second example in more than almost 20 years now, which says something that it's not something that can be accomplished very easily. I think there is a human limit. There is a limit to human lifespan. There are a lot of ethical issues linked to this discussion of extending lifespan that I think should be looked at carefully before thinking about making everybody live to 1,000 years. So it's a very complicated problem. But so far there are, there are no, in the United States, we haven't seen anybody reaching the age of Sarah Knaus so far. There's been a claim a couple of weeks ago of a person in Indonesia who claimed to be 140, but there are a lot of such claims that then typically tend to be proved to be false. So far, we just have one example of a really extended life.
Well, I think if I hit three digits, I might become forgetful about how old I really was. So that's understandable.
So it's more fun if we disagree slightly. So, I mean, there's a question whether I would like there to be a human limit or not, and that's different, but is there a human limit on aging? I would say that there's no biological reason to think that there should be. So, I mean, aging doesn't, in my mind, exist for a reason. It exists because during the course of evolution, none of us lived long enough to see aging. We died of something else. And so now we've got public health and hospitals. Now our bodies are living a lot longer than they were ever evolved to live, and so we're falling apart in different processes. That's not true for all species. You can get some species don't age at all, or you have clams which can live for 600, 700 years. There's no biological potential limit on a cell's capacity to live. It just happens that evolution had no reason to make us live a long time, because during the course of evolution, we tended to die of something else. The only things that really age are animals in zoos and pets. And so I think it would be, evolution is a much better geneticist than any of us. So it's very unlikely we could undo all of that capacity in 100 years, in 20 years. But should there be a kind of intellectual reason why humans can't live past 120? I can't think of a biological reason.
Let me start with some of your guys' questions. For any panel member who wishes to try this one, so statistically, women tend to outlive men. Why might that be so at the cellular or molecular level that you guys look at?
Well, part of it is that men are more susceptible to cardiovascular disease than women are, and so the rates are just higher. So some of that difference is due to that. You're more susceptible to atherosclerosis as a man than you are as a woman. But as a woman, atherosclerosis is still going to be a major risk factor for death. So all Americans or all people should really do everything to minimize that risk. But that explains some of the difference.
I mean, violence in men dying from violent deaths is much more common. But at the cellular level, Alzheimer's disease is actually more common in females than in men. And many neurological diseases have these sex biases. And we don't know. We don't know. And it's an understudied and underfunded area of research, is why some women are more susceptible to Alzheimer's and men are more susceptible to Parkinson's, for example. Mm.
But there could also be a different history of non-genetic risk factors that men and women have different. Like smoking, it was traditionally much more common in men, and I think maybe the differences now are a little less strong as before. But historically, men used to smoke much more and drink more than women. And I think that in part explains why at the very old age, we see more women than men.
So before we leave men and women, so your lab mice don't smoke or not smoke. Your lab mice don't get killed in wars or not killed in wars. So is the sex difference we see in human people, is that mirror something that you see in lab animals? Do female mice live longer than male mice, et cetera? Do we know that?
There are sex differences. They can be strain dependent. So it's not an easy answer. And it's dependent also across different organisms. And there are other non-human species where the male is the longer lived of the species. So you can't universally generalize that females are longer lived. I also wanted to add one other point to that, which is just to make sure that we make the distinction that because one sex may be longer lived, that doesn't necessarily mean the aging rate is different for that. Yeah. For that sex. And so there are some studies in human populations that suggest that the burden of age-related disease is actually higher in women than it is in men. So, you know, the effects on health span and the effects on lifespan are not always hand in hand.
Another great question. So several of you told us about various ways we can live our lives to reduce our risk of disease, especially age-related disease, et cetera. So that's all well and good. But anyone who watches late night TV or opens many magazines, whatever, is bombarded with, here is something that will, you know, keep you young past your prime or whatever. Are there any, what we would call, interventions, therapeutic or not, over the counter, whatever? Again, we want a pill. So is there anything that...
So eat right and exercise doesn't count?
No. Thank you. I see some shaking of heads in the audience. We all agree. So is there anything, I'm guessing not out there now, but is there conceivably anything, we talked about the possibility of mimicking with something drug-ish, the caloric restriction, for instance, or is there going to be a GFP pill? I know you're all dying to answer this one, so whoever is brave enough to go first.
I don't think there's going to be a single aging pill anytime in the near future. But Amy was joking about exercise and what you put in your mouth. I mean, those are really awfully important things, and they don't cost as much as any of the drugs on the market. So, we still are waiting answers on caloric restriction. We don't know what diets sometimes exactly to eat, but we know some things that we shouldn't eat and some things that we shouldn't do. So I think for the foreseeable future, buying those things that are being sold now for aging is not as good as taking care of yourself.
Right. And in particular, there is possible intervention sold by the anti-aging industry that actually can be really damaging. So rather than they may give you a boost of energy or something in a short time, but they may have really negative consequences. And it's these are things that are very difficult to regulate. And I agree, I appear a lot on TV. If you watch, I do a lot of work at night, so I watch a lot of TV around 2 o'clock in the morning. And you see a lot of shows trying to sell this incredible intervention for magic pills to make you reverse the clock, but...
Not yet, okay.
Not yet, we're not there yet.
Okay. We're not gonna end on a down note, don't worry. if I could address this to Tracy, a question from the audience is whether there are any reliable tests to indicate the approaching onset of Alzheimer's. It doesn't say specifically, but if you could speak just a teeny bit to some of the imaging possibilities, especially in light of your point that there are a lot of people who have plaques and tangles and seem cognitively just fine.
Yeah, this is a very active area of research because as I alluded to, if we can intervene early, we're going to be much more successful at in these clinical trials for these new drugs that are coming up. And the answer is there is an imaging, a PET-based imaging methodology called PIB imaging that can detect amyloid plaques in your brain. And there's definitely significant differences between cognitively normal people and Alzheimer's disease people. But then there is this subset of people that will have a signal by PET, PIB, who remain cognitively normal and who are not affected. And those are that group of people that I very much want to study and try to understand why that is. So it's not definitive, but it is definitely something that, for example, the drug companies now are using to stratify their drug trials. They do PIB imaging as a measure of how well their drug is working, or and also who to enroll. So that is a great, it's great, but it's not definitive. And then there are many different blood-based biomarker studies out there now, and those are getting better and better at predicting Alzheimer's. Mm. And I would predict in the next few years that we'll have a blood test that can very reliably predict whether you will become have Alzheimer's within a few years. But right now, we're not quite there yet.
So not to put you on the spot, except yeah. That is my job, would you want to know?
Would I want to know? So I would today, because there are trials today that are super exciting, and I'm very enthusiastic about this Biogen trial and related trials, where if they can, if I knew, and I think I'm cognitively normal now, if I knew that I was at high risk, I would enter those trials. Mm. And that is an option. That is an option for people who think that they are at risk, but do not yet have Alzheimer's. They can look into some of these trials that are available today.
So we might escape the evening without a resveratrol question, because the one on this was crossed out, and no one volunteered that they're taking resveratrol in the previous question. But instead, this question asks about the insulin signaling pathway and whether it influences aging, and if it does in a significant way, should we choose foods based on how much they give us an insulin spike? I'm not sure that's not addressed to anyone in particular, so whoever wishes to take that on.
Well, Bill, you.
I mean, foods, well, insulin.
So does it affect the aging rate in the lab? Certainly it does. So all those slides I put up of the different interventions which were making organisms live longer were a massive suppression of the insulin signaling pathway. You wouldn't want to do that yourself. That would make you diabetic. So those animals were, by definition, insulin resistant. And so that's not a therapeutic we want to induce. However, I think, as we've talked a lot about, diet does have a massive effect on broad health, whether it's aging rates or cognitive decline. I think certainly choosing a diet which has a low glycemic index and is healthy will have a good influence on your health, I think. But would you want to mimic those studies directly? No, I don't think you would.
So we have, yes, go ahead.
I think it's actually a fascinating question. But we have so much data. We do have data on things like eating healthy to lower your blood pressure and to try to minimize your risk of cardiovascular disease. And so I think it's a fascinating question, but I would say if you want to take that route, we have a lot of really good dietary advice that is proven in humans.
We have two questions on hearing loss. I don't think I saw it on any of your slides as a morbidity associated with aging. But do you either, I guess for Pella, in the centenarian study, do you evaluate hearing and hearing loss as part of, you know, the assessment of where people are? And let's see, was it you, Will, who looked at the accumulation of comorbidities and whether hearing loss is a significant one there? I mean, I think we all believe is associated with aging. But for anyone who wants to talk about the importance of hearing loss, especially for health span, if that's appropriate?
In centenarians, we see that this is a pretty common problem. And probably it's as common as also having eyesight problems. And when you have used them, it's like your car. If you drive, you know, 200,000 miles, after a while, pieces of the body start falling, you know, having a little problems. I think, however, there are a lot of things that can be done to actually improve the quality of life. So hearing loss doesn't seem to be one of the markers of aging poorly in people. So I think the two things are, I haven't seen any correlation. And again, there are centenarians who are doing very well who have issues of hearing loss.
As long as your voice is warmed up, we have a question about whether the incidence of centenarians differs by ethnic groups. Some of us are in this audience are old enough to recall the idea that people in the former Soviet Republic of Georgia just outlived us all, and I believe it was because of yogurt. So if you could just address
that. Would have been an easy intervention, right, to eat yogurt. It turns out that a lot of those claims were not real. So yogurt is good, but it doesn't make you live to 120. I don't think that's the secret. There are a lot of issues in understanding the effect of ethnicity and the prevalence of centenarians with different ethnicities. In the United States, the studies of centenarians typically are studies with mainly white people. And again, is this an issue of, you know, there are different reasons why people don't want to get enrolled in studies. And so it's difficult to say whether there is a ethnicity related to the ability of some individuals to reach very old ages. So it's not clear. There are countries in which there are no data about centenarians. And in Asia, for example, there are some studies in China and Japan and Korea that have demonstrated, have collected a lot of data on centenarians, but other countries in which we have no data. We have no data in Africa, we have no data in India. So it's hard to answer this question. We need more data to answer this question.
This is a heart question, so we can start with Rich. What can you tell us about, so we've been talking about slowing aging, you know, compressing the decline to just the last few minutes of life. We haven't talked about reversing. So for, again, many of us here, we've gotten to the point where we want to reverse it. So is there anything in cardiovascular land? We have, many of us, heard of Dean Ornish's diet, for instance, and his intervention. Is there anything that will, whatever age you are, whatever age your heart and lungs, et cetera, are they can turn back the clock?
Some of it is the atherosclerosis part, and it is true, if you can live like a rabbit and eat vegetables only, that probably is good for you. There's also issues about blood pressure, I think, that are important no matter how old you are. Mm. Blood pressure naturally goes up as you age, and we now know that that's not a good thing. And so really looking at your blood pressure and what you eat and how it contributes to your blood pressure is going to help your heart. The heart can change shape very quickly. It can change shape and release a lot of this muscle in just a couple of weeks. So the response to blood pressure is enormous. And that's one of the reasons I think following those healthy diet things is important.
Amy, I think it was you who mentioned several blood factors. Actually, you did also, Rich, with the yes, GDF-11. So I'm not yet prepared to give up on reversing aging. So my question is, if a little GDF-11/8 is associated with slowing the rate of aging and the other things that you noted, and Amy, and correct me if I'm misremembering, research has identified some factors in the blood, again, associated with aging, pace of aging, et cetera. So if a little of that, those things, can slow aging, why can't a whole lot of it taken at some point, like, even better?
Because there's a lot of things going on in the body that can be controlled by these systems, and they're under regulation and control that is complicated, and it takes us a long time to figure them out. And so sometimes you see data where it looks like, okay, if your levels are low, then just raise those levels. That's not always the best approach. And so we need to really understand what we're doing. I do think there are going to be things we can, if you think 30 years ago, we didn't think cholesterol was a real thing. Now we know it's absolutely critical. So it takes us a long time to figure these things out. But if we figure out the right way to do it, then we can actually do some good.
Yeah, if I could just add to that, I think that it's important to remember that the body is always trying to exist in balance. And for many, many signaling systems, you know, the idea that if more is good, then you know, even more is better, usually doesn't hold up. And if, you know, if you want to take a simple example, you can think about insulin in diabetics. And it's very clear that not enough insulin is bad and too much insulin is bad. And so what you're trying often to do when you're trying to, say, reset a biological system is to hit that set point that's the healthy set point and the sort of window of proper or optimal function of that system.
So, I mean, on the acute stuff also, I do think that in the basic science field, we are beginning to take things like resveratrol, things like rapamycin, things which we've shown previously chronically have an effect on aging in model organisms in the lab, and apply them late on and give short bursts. And in fact, there are some recent data for rapamycin in particular given to mice, middle age really, just for a short period of time, which had an effect on their subsequent aging and other performances in old age. So I think the idea that we might find at least things you can do, you know, you don't have to treat Alzheimer's in a 12-year-old, you can do something late on. We're working on it. I think we're getting there in some ways, to be a bit more positive.
And I'm not being completely facetious here, but again, so the blood factors. Mm-hmm. So maybe we could just leap ahead and not worry about the details and just hook up older people to transfusions from 18-year-olds. So why would that not work?
So you may know that there is a trial ongoing to look at the effects of infusion of young blood in Alzheimer's patients, actually. And it's predicated on some of these studies that have shown that in mice, if you take an older mouse and you expose it to blood factors from mm-hmm. a younger mouse, that actually has beneficial effects in the brain. There's some challenges with that are related to sort of basics of drug development and drug dosing, which is that while the studies that we did in mice used inbred strains that are genetically identical and are aging in a much more homogeneous way, but still actually quite differently on an individual level, humans are even more different. And so you can say, okay, in the average, a 25-year-old looks like this and a 70-year-old looks like this. But if you pick any individual 25-year-old or 75-year-old, their biological age may be quite different. And so your 70-year-old may be biologically 50, and your 25-year-old may be biologically 50. And so if you're doing a blood transfusion and you don't know what the active ingredient of that transfusion is, you don't know how to control your dose, so you don't know how much to give of any individual donor. And when you look at your recipient, you don't know how much they got, because you can't actually measure that. And for any other drug, you would be measuring the dose in, and you would be measuring the amount that's actually delivered to the patient. So the challenge there is actually that humans are not homogeneous in that way. So those kinds of studies have practical limitations unless you have a target that you can actually monitor.
Let me try a question that we got from Twitter. Whoever wants to take this on, can you discuss the relationship, if any, between high intake of sugar and either rate of aging or risk of some of the chronic age-related diseases you have discussed?
It's a really hot question now that how added sugars are actually hurting us, and whether they're hurting us, whether they're just supplying calories or whether the fructose side of the sugar is actually doing direct damage. I come down on the fructose side. I think that there's a lot of data that added sugars and the fact that our diets now have gotten so sweet over the past 30 or 40 years that is something that we should be avoiding, but it's extremely controversial.
I also think that, which is really, that we haven't talked much about today. We've talked about the epidemic of aging, but there's also the epidemic of obesity, certainly in the US, and obese patients aren't just at risk for type 2 diabetes. They also have earlier onset of Alzheimer's and of cancer and of many of these other age-related diseases. And so, in fact, you could argue in some ways, it's a bit controversial, that obesity is slightly an accelerated aging phenotype. And so the links between diet and aging go beyond, you know, just dietary restriction. It's also the other side of the coin is important, and we have to think about that when we think about risk.
Now, an observation linked to the use of sugar, the Japanese population has the longest life expectancy, and of course their diet now is changing, but the tradition was there was no sugar and a lot of good things for you, maybe not so good to eat, but good things for you, the sugar.
Mm-hmm. We're running out of time, but let me try to get in one question about stroke. So we're going back to Rich and the cardiovascular system. What sort of work is underway about how stroke might cause deterioration of the brain, obviously, which seems similar to Alzheimer's, at least sometimes in its phenotype, but doesn't show the plaques and tangles, et cetera, and whether risk, especially of small strokes, is, how that comes about with aging.
Yes, so some component of dementia can be from multiple very small vascular strokes. Exactly what that percentage is, I don't think we know, but clearly some patients have that. And that's a group of people where you look back and you wonder if we could have controlled their blood pressure better and we could have made more an impact on their atherosclerosis, could we have actually prevented that? So, but that fits within that same bucket of we actually know how to do that part of life, and we ought to be applying that more aggressively across the population. Mm.
Well, thank you. I apologize to everyone whose questions I didn't get to. However, our panelists have graciously agreed to hang around for a little bit. So if you have a question that you would like to ask them, feel free to, you know, hang out at the stage after we're done. And in the meantime, if you would join me in thanking them for their time.